John chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from the scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying, and as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and to your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told him that he had said these things to her. May God bless the reading of his word.
Thank you.
You have your Bibles. We're going to look at John chapter 20. We're going to be jumping around a bit. So we know all four Gospels describe the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I was thinking about those three words, He is risen. And I was thinking back to April 19th, 1775, the events leading up to the Revolutionary War. The shots were fired at British troops during the Battle of Concord, which marked America's first victory against a powerful British army. And that in turn sparked the Revolutionary War and led to America's independence from Britain. And that's where we heard the phrase was coined, the shot heard round the world. That first shot that took place of the Revolutionary War. The shot heard round the world. Well, the proclamation that He is risen was a proclamation that rang out 2,000 years ago, and that was not just heard around the world. It was heard all the way back to Adam and all the way ahead to the end of time. He is not here. He is risen. Every man, woman, boy, or girl who's ever been saved has been saved because of the reality of that great proclamation and what it implies. And that is what we want to consider this morning. That little phrase, He is not here. Well, why isn't He here? That's what the angels told Mary. He's not here. Well, why? Was He stolen by His disciples? Did He wake up and somehow escape? That He wasn't really dead? Did He just vanish into thin air? Was it the wrong tomb? Those are all things people put forth as to why the tomb was empty, but obviously none of them hold any water because the guards were guarding the wrong tomb. Mary saw where He was buried. The angels went to the wrong tomb. He's not here. Well, why isn't He there? Why? That is a very important question. Why is He risen? What does it mean? The angel said to Mary, come and see the place where He was lying. He was there, but He's not there anymore. And what I want us to do through this morning is look at the place where He was lying. And as we do, we're going to see that it indeed is empty. There's probably no greater verification of any event really in Christ's life and the fact that the tomb is empty. But what are the implications of the empty tomb? That's what we need to understand. What does the Bible say about the empty tomb? What does the Bible say about the cross? Because you cannot separate the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They're inseparably linked. You cannot have one without the other. If we have one without the other, they're both rendered irrelevant. The cross is significant because of the empty tomb. The empty tomb is significant because of what was accomplished on the cross. And so that's what we want to think about this morning for a few minutes. What is man's biggest problem, greatest problem? Man's greatest problem is sin. It's a problem in two ways. First, it's an internal problem. My heart is deceitful and desperately wicked, and that applies to everyone who's ever been born. All my righteousness are as filthy rags. My heart is wrong. Everything about me is wrong from the inside out. But it begins in my heart. The second problem we have is external, that we've sinned. That wickedness that lives within every heart manifests itself in rebellion against God. We've broken God's law. And so sin defiles us from the inside and on the outside as well. We've all sinned. We're all sinners. The fact that it defiles us refers to who we are. The fact that it condemns us has to do with what we've done. That's how man is. That's how we're born into this world. Sin reigns in us. And sin's penalty is crying out for the death penalty. The wages of sin is death. And even if somehow we were able to free himself from sinning, if we could reach a place where we don't sin anymore, we would still be hopeless because of the sin's penalty, that even one sin is enough to send men to eternity in hell forever. What do you do with that sin? What do you do with the sin I committed yesterday? If I could find maybe in 10 years, I could somehow start living a perfect life. What about all the sins I've committed up to that point? We're hopeless. The wages of sin is death. There's nothing I can do to change that. I can't atone for it. All I can do is pay the wage. Death. But that's how everyone's status is before a holy God. It's how we were born in this world. We were lost and without hope. So the gospel of Christ saves man not only from the power of sin, but also from the penalty of sin. So how is one made right with God? There's only one answer, and it's through the life and the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:20 to 21, therefore we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were making an appeal through us. We beg you, on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. He made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. If you're listening to this and you don't know Christ, we're begging you. The message of the gospel is we implore you to be reconciled to God. And there's only one way you can do that, and it is through Jesus Christ. But Paul makes an interesting statement in Romans chapter 4, verse 25, concerning the resurrection, the death and resurrection of Christ. He was delivered over because of our transgressions. He died on the cross for our transgressions. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquity. The Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. And then he adds, he was raised because of or for our justification. Romans 4:25. And that's what I want to talk about this morning. I want us to see the importance of the resurrection of Jesus Christ by what Paul says here. He was raised because of our justification. What does it mean to be justified? We need to understand that. We need to understand how that relates to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I want to do it by doing what the angels asked Mary to do. Come and see. We want to look into that empty tomb this morning. We want to see the implications of that empty tomb. And we've talked about justification before. We went through Romans a couple of years ago in chapter 3. So some of this is repetition. But we can never talk about justification too much. The Reformers called justification by faith alone the foundation stone of the church. That's what the church is built on, justification by faith alone. So we're going to look at several points. I won't dwell too long on either one of them. But I hope as we do that we will see how the resurrection of Jesus Christ is so important when we talk about the subject of justification. And hope we'll understand it in a way that maybe we never understood it before. First thing I want us to see is that justification is based on the blood of Jesus Christ. Much more than having been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7 says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of trespasses according to the riches of his grace. That we cannot separate the cross from the resurrection. As I said earlier, one without the other nullifies them both. Peter says, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. We know this, but do we understand what it means? Have you ever thought about and meditated and about what it means that we are justified on the basis of the blood of Christ alone? There's nothing in us, there's nothing in me, there's nothing in you that causes God to justify me. It's not our repentance, it's not our faith. Our faith does not pay for our sin. Only the blood of Jesus Christ can pay for sin. We are justified by the blood of Jesus Christ. Our justification is based on the fact that Christ shed his blood for our sin. He died for us. That God laid on him the iniquity of us all. And this is why we know we're secure in Christ. We may have a weak faith, but we're saved by an all-powerful Savior. We are saved by the blood of Christ, by his sacrifice. In Exodus, when the death angel passed through Egypt, God was looking for one thing, if you know the story. It's the 10th plague in Egypt. As God was preparing to lead his children out of the bondage and the slavery of Egypt, and Pharaoh kept saying, you're not going to go, you're not going to let go, and he wouldn't let them go. And finally, the death angel passed over that night. And when that death angel passed through Egypt, God was looking for one thing. He told him to put blood on the sides of the door, blood on the door. And when that angel passed by Israel and Egypt that night, he says, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Those inside those homes may have been filled with fear, trembling, very weak faith, but it didn't make any difference as long as the blood had been applied the way God said it was to be applied. They were saved by the blood. Where do we look for assurance in our life? We do not look inside, we look outside. We must look to Jesus Christ. Our faith and our trust is in him. Our faith and our trust is in his righteousness alone. That's our confidence, and that's our hope. Come, see the place where he was lying. Look, he was lying there. Look and see where he was lying. He, who? Jesus. The one who died on the cross, who shed his blood for your sin, who is our substitute and became our Savior and bore our sins. And he rose again, signifying what? That God had accepted the payment for our sin through his Son, Jesus Christ. We are justified by his blood. To justify means to declare righteous. It doesn't mean to make righteous. We need to understand that. When God justifies us, he declares that something is true about us objectively. He's talking about our standing before the judge. He declares that we are right in the sight of his law. But remember this, justification is a legal declaration. In and of itself, it does not change a person. Yes, we are changed. Yes, we become new creations in Christ, but that's regeneration. Everyone God justifies, he sanctifies, as Romans says. But justification is a statement or a declaration about our standing in the eyes of God. We need to realize that. Justification is a statement or a declaration about where we stand in the eyes of God, the judge. The opposite of justification is to condemn. Romans 8:33, we see this played out. Who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who will condemn? Is Christ Jesus, is he who died? Yes, rather was raised. Who is at the right hand, who also intercedes for us? Justification, the opposite is condemned. Romans 8:1, there's therefore now no what? Condemnation to those who are in Christ. When a judge justifies a man, he does not change who he is on the inside, but it declares him to be right in the eyes of the law. It's a legal declaration, a declaration that God makes concerning all those who place their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. That you were clean. that you have been set free, that you're no longer under condemnation. The price of your sin, the penalty of your sin has been paid by Jesus Christ. And he now declares you to be just as far as the law is concerned. We also need to understand that justification has no degrees. You're either 100% righteous or you're condemned. There's no condemnation to those in Christ Jesus. But Satan is always trying to get us to think we're at least a little bit condemned in the sight of God's law. I mean, after all, nobody's perfect, right? So Satan's always trying to get us to think, you know, hey, what about that little thing you did last week? What about that lie you told? What about this? What about that? And he's always trying to get us to think we're condemned, that God's going to get us. How can you call yourself a Christian if you do stuff like that? But thank God we are not condemned. Satan is still a liar. He's always been a liar and he always will be a liar. And that's a lie he's telling. So don't believe it. The Apostle Paul knew God better than we do. David knew God better than we do, I think, in many respects. But here's a statement we need to contemplate. We are as justified in the eyes of God as Jesus Christ himself is. Now, Jesus obviously did not need to be justified. But we are as righteous in the sight of God as Christ himself is. Why? Because we have been clothed with his perfect righteousness. His righteousness is ours. So our justification, our declaration is not based on our performance, but is based on the performance of Jesus Christ. We'll see a little bit more about that in a minute. But our justification is perfect and it's absolute because it's not based on what I've done, but based on what Christ has done for me and in my place. Another thing we need to recognize is that justification is more than a pardon. When the president or the prime minister pardons someone who's committed a crime, maybe they're on death row and he pardons their sentence. Were their crimes paid for? No. Was their punishment carried out? No. Was justice satisfied? No. Pardon is the act of authority by a governor. It lets a criminal off the hook. But the sentence of the law that they broke is never carried out. Somebody else doesn't stand in their place. The governor just says, we're going to forego that. But by contrast, justification is a declaration by a judge and is in keeping with principles of justice. And we need to realize that. That God can be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Salvation is not God letting us off the hook. Salvation is God not pretending your sentence has been carried out. Rather, he sees that your sins really have been paid. The penalty for your sin was death. And he sees Christ who bore our sin and he punished Christ. Christ bore the hell that we deserved. He bore the wrath of God that we deserved. And he paid the penalty. And as God laid our sin upon him, as his wrath was being poured out for those 3 hours, by the time it was done, the sins were gone. The penalty had been paid. The debt was gone. And had been accepted. How do we know? Because he rose from the dead. Death had lost its sting. Death had lost its grip. It would claim no more victims. Sin's grip had been defeated. He sees that our sins really have been paid for by Christ, and he makes the declaration based on that fact of what Jesus did on the cross. He makes a declaration about the way things really are. Truthfully, they are this way. The only way a repentant sinner can hold up his head is for him to know that his sins have actually been paid for. that Christ really did bear our sin on the cross. God really did pour out his wrath on his own son 2,000 years ago. The penalty for our sin was really paid. An actual debt was paid and accepted 2,000 years ago when Christ suffered on the cross. It was not just figurative. It was not just some nice sentiment. Christ actually bore the penalty for sin on the cross 2,000 years ago. If you have terrible memories in your sinful past, you can be certain of this. Those sins are no longer hanging over your head. They're gone. As far as the east is from the west, the deepest part of the sea, the penalty has been paid for them, and it was complete. They have come down on the Lord Jesus Christ, and he paid for them, actually paid for them. He bore the wrath of God for our sin in his body on the cross. Well, how do we know God accepted the payment for her sin? He was delivered because of our transgressions, was raised because of our sanctification. And so the angel invites us to come to the tomb and go inside. If Jesus is still there, we're still in our sin. The payment was not accepted. He died for his own sin, but he never had no sin. But if Jesus is still there, God says, no, that's not acceptable. They've got to pay for their own sins. But the angel says, come and see the place where he lay. He's not there. He's risen. And the empty tomb means this glorious fact that our debt has been paid in full and that payment was accepted by God. And if that doesn't make you want to stand up and shout, what will? So he wants you to look. Look. He's gone. The fact that Jesus is gone means that our sins are gone. They've been paid in full. What a glorious, glorious truth. Justification, we've already alluded to this, is both positive and negative. There's a negative side to justification, what God does not do, and he does not impute our sin to us. He lays them on his son, Jesus Christ. As we said, Christ paid the debt for our sin on the cross. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds have been forgiven and whose sins have been covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will not take into account, Romans 4:7-8. So the negative side is he forgives our sins, but that just takes us back to zero. But salvation is much, much, much more than just starting over with a clean slate. The positive side to justification is this, that God places on us the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ. His perfect life for 33 years, where he kept the law perfectly, the righteous demands of God's law were satisfied in the life of Jesus Christ and kept perfectly, and that righteousness, the righteousness of Christ, was credited to my account. God places upon us the perfect righteousness of Christ. For the transgression of one, death reigned through the one. Much more those who received the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. For as though one man's disobedience and many were made sinners, even so through the obedience of the one, many will be made righteous. Where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. So that in death reigned in life, even so grace would reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Those who kept the law were promised a blessing. Those who broke the law would be cursed. And what's happening on the cross is Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by having become a curse for us. As it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. The one who never sinned. The only one who's ever lived who really deserved to be blessed was cursed. for us, became a curse for us. He bears our curse of disobedience. He bears the curse of our hatred of God, our sins against God. Well, who inherits the blessing? We do. We do. We inherit the blessing of his obedience, and he inherits the curse of our disobedience. We've been justified by faith. Therefore, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace on both sides, God's side and our side. How can I be sure? How do I know God's wrath has been appeased? Come. Come see the place where he was lying. He's risen. God's wrath against us, we've been reconciled to God through Jesus Christ, his life and his death and his resurrection. Justification is once for all. It's a once for all past completed event with results that last forever. Our salvation is unchangeable. It's as unchangeable as the righteousness of Christ has been imputed to us that we are clothed in. And I can get up every morning knowing that I'm accepted in Christ, knowing that God delights in me as his child, knowing that the guilt and the penalty of my sin are gone forever. Every priest stands ministering and offering to time after time the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But Christ, having offered one sacrifice for sins for all time, sat down at the right hand of God, Hebrews 10:11-12. Justification is a once for all. The cross is not going to be repeated. The resurrection will never be repeated. It was a once for all sacrifice, and that sacrifice was sufficient. Justification is received by faith alone. The blood of Christ is the ground of our justification. Faith is the instrument or the channel by which we receive this gift. What must I do to be saved? Paul told the jailer, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. But we're not saved by faith in general. You hear people talking this weekend about Good Friday and Easter. They talk about this religion celebrates this religion celebrates that. Some religions don't celebrate it at all. And they talk about the what it means. And they know it's the day Jesus died. They know it's the day Jesus was believed to have resurrected. But that's all they say. But saving faith is not believing the events of Good Friday and Easter. It's not just believing Jesus died on a cross. It's not just believing he was rose again the third day. There's all kinds of people around the world who go to church every day, some of them. And there'll be multitudes gathered today on Easter believing that Jesus rose from the dead. But faith in the historical events of the life of Jesus will not save you. Faith in the beauty of Jesus' life will not save you. Faith in the accuracy or goodness of Jesus' teaching will not save you. Faith in the deity of Jesus and his lordship will not save you. What saves us? It's believing what God says about those events that saves us. It's one thing to know the gospel, the truth of the gospel. It's quite another to agree with it. What did I say man's greatest problem is? Sin. Sin. And there's a lot of people that believe Jesus died on the cross and rose again, but it had nothing to do with sin. He was just being a martyr. He was showing people how to live, and he was showing people how to die as a good person. But faith is not just acknowledging the facts of the gospel. It's agreeing with the facts of the gospel as they pertain to God, to Christ, to the cross, and to me, my sin and my guilt, and what Christ was doing on the cross when they hung there 2,000 years ago. Do you agree with the truth of the gospel? That no merit of my own his anger to suppress? Do you still believe that there is some merit in your life? That's why you're saved? Are you going to plead before God some merit when you get to heaven? Lord, we did this. Lord, I did this. Lord, Lord, Lord. And he's going to say what? I never knew you. You have nothing to bring to the table of your salvation. You have nothing to bring to the table of merit before God except your filthy rags. None of us do. When we come before the cross and we come before God one day, we are going to stand there and we are going to plead the righteousness of Christ that's been imputed to us. We are going to plead that all my sin was laid on Him and His righteousness, and I stand there pleading nothing but the perfect righteousness of His Son, Jesus Christ. There's nothing I can do to earn merit before a holy God. That's the gospel, but there's a lot of people sit in churches just like this. Who may mouth the words, they may sing the words in the hymn, but in their heart of hearts, they don't agree with it. They don't agree. They bristle at it. They think there's something I can do. There must be something I've done to contribute something. There's churches all across the world, all across North America, who would acknowledge the statements as facts of the gospel, but yet in their heart of hearts, they do not agree with them. Yet they still call themselves Christian, but they're not. The reasoning seems to be that somehow not agreeing with these basic truths of the gospel is not as bad as not believing them. And whether you can really acknowledge them as true and not believe them at the same time is debatable. But that is the reasoning of a deceived heart. Can you really believe in something you don't agree with? Well, you can believe Jesus died on the cross, but not agree with the fact that He died for sin. Or not believe the fact, you can believe that He died on the cross, but not agree with the fact that that's the only way you can be saved. I can contribute to something. Or maybe people around the world are doing something different, but they'll be saved too. That's becoming more popular all the time. But there's no one, not name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved other than that of Jesus Christ. To reject the cross, Christ dying on a cross in our place as our substitute, is to deny the basic tenet of the gospel. And if you reject that, you've rejected your Savior. There's no other gospel. By the works of the flesh, no one will be justified. So let me ask you again. Do you deep down in your heart, in your prayers, in your thinking, in your motivation, in your giving, as you explain the gospel to others, do these truths become evident that you agree with the doctrine of justification by grace alone through faith alone? Or do you in reality affirm a good works righteousness? You just need to come to church. Start giving. Be a better person. Do the best you can and just wait and see. And God's a loving God. And if you do the best you can, that's all you can expect. The believing heart affirms the truth it receives from God's word. It believes what the word of God says about what Christ was doing on the cross and what He was accomplished through His resurrection. It rejoices the heart. And only faith in what Scripture tells us Jesus did for us on the cross will save us. We are saved by faith in Christ and what He did on the cross for us. We are saved by His death and resurrection. One writer has said, the wisdom of God who knows the unbelief of human nature has provided a great cloud of witnesses on the subject. Never was there a fact which the friends of God were so slow to believe as the resurrection of Christ. Never was there a fact which the enemies of God were so anxious to disprove. And yet, in spite of the unbelief of professed friends, the hostility of His enemies, the fact was thoroughly established. As I was thinking about that this week, this statement I've heard before, you probably heard it before as well, that the stone was rolled away not to let Jesus out, but to let us in. He could have easily left the stone covered, and Jesus could have easily resurrected. He went through the stone the same way He could have gone through the door, and He did. And they could have left the stone in the door, and nobody would have ever known, other than the fact, I want you to believe that He's not there. I want you to believe that Jesus rose from the dead. I want you to believe it. And we would. We could believe it, just like we believe He was dying on the cross for sin. We believe it because Scripture says it. But I think this was an important enough event, the clincher in this whole plan of salvation, that God didn't want us to, we live by faith and not by sight. But it's interesting how many times in John's Gospel you see the word saw. Let me just read them. John chapter 20, verse 5, and stooping and looking in, he saw the linen wrappings, but he did not go in. So Simon Peter came following him and entered the tomb, and he saw the linen wrappings lying there. Verse 8, when the other disciple had first come to the tomb, then he also entered and he saw and believed. Talking about Mary, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the foot. Verse 14, when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. In the verse 18, Mary Magdalene came announcing to the disciples, I have seen the Lord. And he said these things to her. Remember we read earlier at the beginning, they rejoiced at what they had seen and heard. God wants us to come, look inside the tomb. He wants us to know, he wants us to see that Christ is risen. He's not there. He's risen. We have faith in the fact that he's risen. We have faith in the fact that we understand what that, the application of that on the cross, what Christ was doing on the cross, was finalized and shown to be true. And we can stake our life on it, our eternity on it. Why? Because Christ is not there. He's risen. And God wants us to see that with our, the eyes of faith, if you will. But he wanted those men and women so they could pass it on. We saw him. We saw him. And we believe what the cross says about what he did on the cross. And we believe what the resurrection means. That his debt was accepted by Christ. Our sins have been paid. It's empty. God accepted the payment for sin. If you're looking for your sin, look in the tomb. If he's there, your sin is there. If it's not, it's gone. It's empty. My sin is gone. My shame, my guilt, my despair, they're gone. Come and see. Look. Look. It's gone. It's finished. He's risen. And he's victorious. So I think we can see that the cross and the resurrection are not things that should be relegated to a weekend once a year. These truths should flood our hearts and empower us and excite us every day we get out of bed. Remembering who we are in Christ. Remembering what it means to be justified, declared righteous. Not to mention the fact that we've been born again, we've become a new creation. We've been buried with him through baptism into death so that Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father so that we too might walk in newness of life. For if we become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we also will be in the likeness of his resurrection. He lives, and so shall I live forever together with him. These are glorious truths, and I feel like I'm falling all over myself here trying to show you the glory and the wonder of them because I can't. But Paul said, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil in the Lord is not in vain. So come. Look inside. See where he lay. He's not here. He's risen. May that truth just radiate through our lives, through our hearts. May we rejoice as we think about what it means that he was raised for our justification. And may we just, that new song that he's put in our mouth, praise to our God, be sung from the hilltops. That we can tell this lost and dying world that not only is he risen, he's coming back. And he's coming back not as Savior. He's coming back as a judge, to judge sin, to judge all those who have rejected his sacrifice on the cross, rejected his word, rejected who he is. But if you know him, you never need fear, because all your sins have been laid on him. And the penalty was paid, the wrath was laid on, poured out, and they're gone. They're gone. And he rose again the third day, victorious. And you can lay your head in your pillow at night and give thanks for the glorious salvation that we have in Jesus Christ, who lives in us and we in him. So may this truth encourage us, excite us, fill us with joy, as it should, as it did the disciples. We can't stop talking about the things we've seen and heard. May that be true of us. Father, we thank you for these words this morning, your word, for these glorious truths that we've just sort of skimmed over the surface of. But what glorious truths they are. So many people don't understand the wonder and the glory of justification by faith alone in Christ, by grace alone, through faith alone in Christ alone. By grace, we don't deserve it, we don't merit it, we don't earn it. There was nothing in us that merited such divine favor. It was grace. We love you because you first loved us. In all of eternity, we'll be marveling at this truths we've been looking at this morning. And Father, we thank you for our standing before a holy God that is perfect. We're clothed in your righteousness, and we thank you that we can come to that throne boldly, clothed in that righteousness, to find grace in our help, to help in our time of need. We thank you for our salvation that Christ has provided, who willingly came and gave his life as a sacrifice for our sin. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. That's why he came. That wasn't a last-minute thing. It wasn't plan B. There was a plan from the foundation of the world that Christ would come into the world to save sinners. So, Father, we thank you for such love, such grace, mercy. We pray, Lord, if there's some here this morning who maybe believe or understand and would nod their head to what we're saying, but yet they don't agree with it deep down in their life, or they've never trusted, they've never prayed and asked you to come into their life and say, Lord, I'm trusting in you, and I'm trusting in you alone as my Savior, my Lord. I believe you took my sin and you hung on the cross to bear its punishment. And I believe you rose again, and I'm now clothed in your perfect righteousness, and I stand before God pleading the righteousness of Christ alone as my Savior. And I want to follow him. I want to live for him. I want him to be magnified and glorified in my life. And when we say that, we are instantly justified, born again, regenerated. We become a new creation in Christ. Our standing before you is, this is one of your children, and that can never change, because the righteousness of Christ will never change. We're saved unto good works, but our works do add nothing to our merit, add nothing to our salvation. They're the evidence that we truly have been born again. So, Father, we pray you might take these words and this great truth we're celebrating today, and may it be a truth we celebrate 365 days a year as we walk in the newness and the power of your resurrection, as you live through us powerfully through your Spirit to your glory and the good of others. We ask these things in Jesus' glorious name. Amen.